On OTV AM, we've got Gary Breen. First here is coming up, but first here is Nathan Murphy and Kevin Kilbane calling that Salah wonder goal yesterday.
He knows what it means. Salah takes the shot. Mo Salah with one of the goals of the season, 25 yards out, smashes a shot into the top corner of the net, and Liverpool are going back on top of the Premier League, and Mo Salah is back to his very, very best. It's Liverpool 2, Chelsea 0. Mo Salah, pick it out.
What a goal. Unbelievable.
Yeah, even Kev was excited.
Even Kev. Which just goes to show how excited he was. Gary Breen, I know we have you here. Even if you never saw football in your life, you'd have to appreciate that Mo Salah goal.
Oh, it was amazing. It really was. And what a moment to get it. The very fact that they'd got the first goal just to settle the nerves. And then the emotion after a wonder strike like that. We can hear it from the guys in commentary, but the atmosphere at the stadium looked immense.
They're back on top now. It's the fairy tale ending, really, if they manage to keep it up. But I suppose the other problem is they have that other piranha in the water, Man City, that's also circling around.
Yeah, exactly. But when you listen to the Liverpool players now, I've just heard the reports of Salah, they believe it. It's not a case of they're hoping that it's going to happen. They genuinely believe that if they win all their games, City will drop points. And you have to look at City, the very fact that they've got such tough games over a 7-day period, Tottenham twice, then United. And then a few days after that, they go away to Burnley, who are resurgent now under Sean Dyche. So it looks like City have it all to do. I was at the City game yesterday and everyone had identified that that's a tough place to go, Selhurst Park. But the reality was, Palace have only won 4 games at home all season. So you were thinking, well, listen, City are going to flex their muscles, show their composure, their character. And they did. They absolutely controlled the game from start to finish. It was only when they allowed a poor free kick to go in that suddenly there was a bit of nerves with 5 or 6 minutes to go. But then he went up the other end and got that third goal. So, listen, they're a fantastic team and it's been an incredible title race.
It's not so much maybe a worry about Liverpool now, considering the way they played yesterday and their running isn't too bad. But do you see enough in Manchester United and maybe Spurs without Kane to do the needful? Because obviously Liverpool are still reliant on that. And Man United, I don't know at the moment, would you have much faith in them beating Man City or even getting a draw?
Well, certainly in the Manchester derby, I'd back City heavily. I think they're far superior to United. I know United had that renaissance under Solskjaer, but they seem like they've reverted to type. They don't look like players capable of getting United back to where they want to be. I think Harry Kane, everyone initially thinks that that's going to really affect Tottenham. I don't think it will have that much of a bearing on it, to be perfectly honest. I think Moura and Son give them real pace and energy running in behind. And that's the way you can hurt this City defence. The problem is you don't get enough of the ball. Having said that, Tottenham are good. They can control possession, as they proved in the first leg of the Champions League quarterfinal. So City really do have it all to do.
I know we say they're difficult games and on paper they would be for any other team, but this is City, so they're probably not that hard for them. That'd be my thinking. So that's, if you were there as a Liverpool fan, you'd still be worried because it's City of all teams.
Yeah, you're right. In terms of their consistency, they've been incredible. And even Guardiola said it yesterday, 183 points over the course of these 2 seasons. That's averaging 2.6 a game. So they know how to get the business done. And really, one of the most noticeable things yesterday was Kevin De Bruyne. He comes back into the team. It was a shock, really, didn't play in that first leg against Spurs. But the very fact he's been out injured, he'll be coming to this business end of the season fresh. And the quality he showed yesterday was absolutely incredible. He was making passes that Guardiola said that a lot of other players don't even see, and he's executing them. There was one particular pass that he played it. He'd done a reverse pass, completely fooled everyone, even Aguero. Had he continued his run, he was in on goal, and it was sensational. And that's the level that he's playing at. So coupled with that with Sterling, who's added goals to his game, we've said so often as a young player that he lacks that composure, that finishing ability. Well, he's got it in abundance now, so they do look like they have those match winners throughout that team.
Just on Raheem Sterling, you know, some kind of parallel with Tiger Woods here in the sense of Tiger Woods with the comeback. Sterling looked to me like a player that you just couldn't coach him to actually do the proper thing in front of goal, Gary, and that he, you know, for all the talent he had, he always just struck me as kind of just maybe just lacked that instinct or maybe game intelligence in front of goal. But you gotta, like, De Bruyne's pass obviously for his first goal was absolutely outrageous and all that, but Sterling's finishing the season and the quality of coaching, and to advertise the quality of coaching, his the change in his game, I think, is quite amazing.
Well, listen, this doesn't get enough chat about this for me in terms of what Guardiola does. Everyone identifies this, he's had brilliant players. But it's what he does on a training field. He improves them. And there's so many of that City squad who've gone to a complete another level. But you're right to highlight Sterling. He missed a what would be a sitter compared to what he's had this season, about 5 or 10 minutes before that first goal. But when that through ball was played, he had a lot of time. He was obviously going to run away from the fullback. He was obviously going to beat the centre half. So he had a lot of time to think about it. And it was those situations, Johnny, you're right, that he used to struggle in. But the composure as he went through, when we were doing the commentary, we didn't feel it would be anything other than a goal. And he finished it brilliantly. That second one was a lovely side foot finish as well, left footed, which is not his strength. But I do believe he has gone to another level. This guy's not even 25 yet. And to think of what he's achieved as a young player, initially coming up from London, going to Liverpool and all this, the pressure associated with that big money move, then having the strength of character to say, listen, I'm not going to achieve what I want at Liverpool. I want to go and win titles. He goes to City. And then to make this racism such a topical thing now, to take on the press and the way he's done it. He's an iconic player and he's an iconic footballer. He's an iconic young man. He's a credit to his family and to his football club.
I couldn't agree more there. Like I spoke about the media and the value of the media, you know, a couple of minutes ago. But the media has been nothing short of disgraceful in the way they've treated...
Oh, they've been racist.
Absolutely disgraceful. And the manner that he has then, on the flip side, dealt with racism, with something with the help of the media to an extent to get that message across, couldn't agree more with Gary. He's an absolute icon for what he's done. And for all the vilification, to have the bravery and just to say, listen, I'm going to get on with it, I'm going to score goals and take it like that.
And also say, I'm also going to take on the racists, which is, yeah, I think is really brave, because that's hard to do. Because you forget, he's really young.
He's really young.
Yeah.
I don't know, like, it's, again, we're talking about sport as a triviality, but he's gone beyond that, Gary, in the sense of being proud of, obviously, you know, his race and being proud of, yeah, of his ability on the pitch and just being proud of who he is.
Well, what's so incredible about him more than anything is that he's done it while he's so relevant, that he's such an important player. Now, the generation I played with, the top players, your Sol Campbells, after they've stopped playing, they then come out and say things like, well, if I wasn't black, I would have been England captain and things like that. And they stopped them. And my frustration today was, why didn't you say it when you had a real voice, when it mattered, when you could influence it, when you're in the height of your career? He's done it now. I think there was a lack of bravery to do it because it could have a negative effect on your career, but he was having none of it. For a young man to have that maturity, that strength of character, I've got nothing for admiration for him. I think he's an absolute credit to football in general.
It's actually a great week for football because we've got Champions League again coming up over the next two nights. And again, we've got City and Liverpool both in action. How do you think it's going to pan out?
Well, I think Liverpool's result makes them feel comfortable. I don't think they can be complacent, but I think that they'll go through. Certainly City have got a tough job now. Pep Guardiola said that losing 1-0 is a better result than 0-0. I found that difficult to understand, but I think his point is that they know what they have to do now. They have to really go after Spurs. I think they will do. I think they'll have more control possession. But again, Lucas Moura gets a hat-trick for Tottenham at the weekend. Son looks a different player when he's expected to lead the line and Harry Kane's not there. So they have some real dangers. I think there's going to be an absolute classic Champions League encounter.
We have, so Tuesday we have Barcelona against United and Juventus against Ajax, then Wednesday Porto and obviously Liverpool are 2-0 up going over there, and Man City down a goal against Spurs. So I don't understand why more people aren't saying, could Liverpool do the double?
Well, listen, they could do. I think only Porto said that they were happy to get Liverpool in that quarterfinal draw. I think everyone else would be delighted to avoid them. And I think it'll be a case that whoever they go up against now, Liverpool can open any team up. They proved that even a team as gifted as Manchester City, they put them to the sword last year in the Champions League. They could do it to any one of those remaining teams. And they'll believe that they can add that Premier League title. Everyone's talking about now, what's the obsession for Liverpool? It is mainly that Premier League title. But they have a very real, genuine chance of actually winning the Champions League also.
Do you think, like, again, I find it quite weird, like, people say, then talk about Liverpool, they're like, oh, Champions League's a distraction, they want the Premier League.
Yeah.
I don't think they mind either way, would they?
No, I get the feeling that the Champions League this year, it sounds absolutely bizarre, but, like, if you offered any Liverpool fan the league now, they literally would say, we don't give a damn about the Champions League. And I mean that. It's a bit like Galway Hurlers and Mayo Footballers. It's just been so long that the agony is just like, they just want to win the league, get it out of the way. They've won the Champions League already. I know they obviously went very close last year, but if you offered Liverpool fans the Champions League now but didn't win the league, I don't think most of them would take that.
What do you think, Gary?
And the flip side of that is, I think if you offered the City supporters the Champions League, would they sacrifice the Premier League?
Absolutely.
I think they probably would.
Absolutely.
Football, But football doesn't work like that, does it? You can't pick and choose.
I do think, though, with Liverpool, I'd still prefer to be in Man City's shoes, because it's just they control their destiny. I know they haven't an easy run in, but, like, Gary, if you're a player, you know, would you not prefer to be in the Man City team now? You have De Bruyne back, and as you say, De Bruyne is basically like a new signing. To me, he's the best player in the world, apart from Messi, probably. But he's the best player in the world on his game, best player in the Premier League. Anyway, he's like a new player. You go into these games now, you're looking at De Bruyne, the way he's playing, you're like, I'd prefer to be in the Man City team to basically be able to say, we can decide this ourselves by just winning all our games, as opposed to Liverpool, who are reliant on them slipping up.
Yeah, listen, you always want to be in control of your own destiny. The only problem you have is that congestion of games. Mm. The Liverpool have a nice breather between each one of them, so you expect them to see everyone through. And I know everyone would argue the case, well, listen, they've assembled a squad, City, to cope with these demands. They've got such strength in depth. But even the likes of Aguero looked tired yesterday, and you're hoping now that he can just get that re-energy. I'll counter that by saying, as you rightly said, De Bruyne's back, Mendy's back, he gives him real energy. Sane hasn't played as many games as you would expect, certainly since they lost to Newcastle, so he's full of energy as well. So I it's such a difficult one to call, it really is.
Oh, that's a great place to leave it. Gary Breen, thank you very much for your time this morning. Chat again soon.